Achtung, Achtung! Hier ist die Sendestelle Berlin. Wunder. Auf Welle 400 Meter. Meine Damen und Herren, wir machen Ihnen davon Mitteilung, dass am heutigen Tage der Unterhaltungs-Rundfunkdienst mit Verbreitung von Musikvorführungen auf drahtlos telefonischem Wege beginnt. Die Benutzung ist genehmigungspflichtig.
Jeffersonville, 338, Sweetwater, Virginia, Route.
Calling cars 19 and 38. Proceed immediately to the corner of Croft and Jackson and make an investigation.
This is modern communication, nerve system of the world, spanning oceans as easily as it covers the miles from farmhouse to town. Yet without an unimpressive looking little bottle of magic, we call it simply the electron tube, there would be no communications as we know them today. How does this magic bottle work? Well, the tube and its essentials is relatively simple, consisting of an evacuated glass bulb with three electrodes, a filament, a plate, and between them, DeForest's ingenious grid. When the filament is heated, electrons, nature's elementary particles of electricity, boil off. Being negative, electrons are attracted by the positive plate. Their flow constitutes a current of electricity. Now the genius of DeForest enters. By making the grid alternately positive and negative, the flow of current is greatly increased and then proportionately retarded. In effect, charges placed on the grid produce greatly magnified images of themselves, and the tube thus acts as an amplifier.
Electronics is a science that applies these tubes to the service of man, to the speeding of production, to the winning of the war. To understand how electronic tubes work, let's take a good look at one of them.
Why do more people like it? Why do more people want it? Why do more people buy it than many other TV? Well, the tubes are connected to the chassis. The chassis connected to the picture tube. The picture tube connected to the tuning dial. The tuning dial connected to the cabinet. And the name goes on right here.
Thank you. Is this on?
This cylindrical object, which I'm holding up, is a device that can amplify electrical signals as they are transferred through it. It is composed entirely of cold, solid substances. We call it a transistor.
Shockley, the inventor of the junction transistor. He was head of the team at Bell Laboratories, which developed the first transistor, and for this, the three men were awarded the Nobel Prize in 1956.
I was given a lecture by the then research director, Dr. Kelly, saying that he looked forward to the time when we would get all of the relays that make contacts in telephone exchange out of the telephone exchange and replace them with something electronic so they'd have less trouble. And I wanted to get back to solid-state physics, which was the field in which I got my PhD, and I tried to see how to put these two things together, how to do something electronic and make amplifiers, but to do it not with vacuum, not with a vacuum of vacuum tubes, but to try to find out some way to do this with solid materials. Matter of fact, all of the theory that we needed to do transistors had been well developed before we really got one to work, and even after the point contact first worked, it was still some time before we saw the really simpler matter of the junction transistor. It's quite possible that a transistor might have been invented back in 1915.
Could we have skipped the whole vacuum tube technology then?
Well, I would be very reluctant to take a position on that because of the extremely competitive attitude between the vacuum and the solid state electronics. I think they have been supplementary, and there are many things that can be done with vacuum tubes that the transistor can't do today, and this may remain. Of course, there's competition. People are hoping that somehow, by solid-state means, one will be able to make a flat television tube, for example.
Papa loves Mambo, Mama loves Mambo. Look at him sway with it, getting so gay with it, shouting ole with it, wow.
But before they could introduce their revolutionary new radio, the Regency Company, in partnership with Texas Instruments, introduced the TR-1 in 1954, just in time for Christmas. Small enough to fit in a shirt pocket, the TR-1 sold for $49.95, more than three times the cost of a vacuum tube radio. Even so, they sold every one they could make. Other American radio makers followed, but even at $50 each, they couldn't turn a profit. So American companies left the pocket radio business.
Moments of farewell. The photographers are taking their last shots. Our space rocket is ready in the center of the cosmodrome. The countdown begins. Now only a few moments remain. All eyes fixed on the clock. 30 seconds. 10 seconds. Five. The hand reaches vertical. A mighty roar. Our rocket vibrates. White hot flame gushes downward. And the great beast lifts slowly from the earth. To create a new planet that we will call Sputnik. is small, this first satellite, but after it, we will launch others. In the olden days, explorers like Vasco da Gama and Columbus had the good fortune to open up the terrestrial globe. Now we have the good fortune to open up space, and it is for those in the future to envy us our joy.
When the rocket reached a speed of 18,000 miles an hour, its flame went out, and in the silence of space, it joined the moon in orbit around the Earth. Then, its casing opened, the springs snapped, and the nose cone was pushed out of the way. A ball with four antennae emerged to go it alone in the darkness of space. And a radio began to send a signal back to Earth. Humanity had entered the space age.
Then called circuit miniaturization, and chose TI as one of the more promising places. They were really the only one that offered to let me work full-time on the kind of thing I wanted to do. I could have started at Motorola, and they thought that I could work on that stuff half-time and work on their transistor products the other half, see how these would fit into TI. It became very clear that the only thing that TI could make effectively at that time were semiconductor products. So since it had to be semiconductors, I began to think about how much you could do with semiconductors and realized that you could make all the circuit elements that you needed that way. Well, the initial process was mostly in thinking about it, sketching things on paper, not much physical effort for several months. At the end of that period, we actually began to try to build something, and the first circuit was finished in September. I thought that if it could be made successfully, that it would have a big impact on electronics as we knew it. I had no idea of how much a million to one cost reduction would expand the field of electronics. I don't think anybody did. And it wouldn't have had to be that ugly. If I had known I was going to have to look at it for 40 years, I'd have prettied it up a little bit.
Many people do not realize today that the ultimate worth of the integrated circuit was not universally recognized in the early 60s. It was viewed by many serious thinkers with great skepticism. I remember at a conference in Seattle, and I think it was 1965 or 66, I was almost hooted off the stage for having made some positive comments about the future of integrated circuits.
But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the others too.
Liftoff. Liftoff, 30 minutes after the hour.
At the foot of the ladder, the Lambert beds are only depressed in the surface about 1 or 2 inches, although the surface appears to be very, very fine-grained as you get close to it. It's almost like a powder. Ground mass is very fine. And then along with
okay, I'm going to leave that 1 foot up there and both hands down about the fourth rung up.
There you go.
Okay, now I think I'll do the same.
For those who haven't read the plaque, we'll read the plaque that's on the front landing gear of this LAM. There's two hemispheres, one showing each of the two hemispheres of Earth. Underneath it says, "Dear men from the planet Earth, first set foot upon the moon, July 1969,
AD. I guess you're about the only person around that doesn't have TV coverage of the scene.
That's alright, I don't mind a bit. How is the quality of the TV?
Oh, it's beautiful, Mike. It really is.
Oh, geez, that's great. Is the lighting halfway decent?
Yes, indeed. They've got the flag up now, and you can see the stars and stripes from up.
Complete Houston. After serving the world for over 30 years, the space shuttle's earned its place in history. It's come to a final stop.
We copy your will stop, and we'll take this opportunity to congratulate you, Atlantis, as well as the thousands of passionate individuals across this great spacefaring nation.
Discovery Houston, 20 seconds to LOS Tedris.
Roger, it's nice to be in orbit.
Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11. Tower cleared.
Here, we got a roll program.
By making things smaller, everything gets better at the same time. The transistors get faster, the reliability goes up, the cost goes down. It's a unique violation of Murphy's Law. I was asked by Electronics Magazine to predict what was going to happen in electronic components in the next 10 years. I looked at what we had been doing, and we were making integrated circuits with increasing complexity, but not very complex. The first ones had about 4 components on it. A year later, 8. And I plotted this out, and I thought, geez, from the introduction of the first planar transistor in 1959, the complexity on a chip had about doubled every year. And it was getting up towards 60 when I looked at it in 1965. And I wanted to predict that this was going to be the way to make electronics inexpensively, which was not generally acknowledged at that time. So I took this doubling every year and extrapolated it 10 years from 1965 to 1975, from 60 components to 60,000 components on a chip. A pretty wild extrapolation. And it turned out to be ridiculously accurate.
It sure is great to get out of that bag. And accustomed as I am to public speaking, I'd like to share with you a maxim I thought of the first time I met an IBM mainframe. Never trust a computer you can't with. Obviously I can talk, but right now I'd like to sit back and listen. So it is with considerable pride that I introduce a man who's been like a father to me, Steve Jobs.
I think everybody in this country should learn how to program a computer, should learn a computer language, because it teaches you how to think. It's like going to law school. I don't think anybody should be a lawyer, but I think going to law school would actually be useful because it teaches you how to think in a certain way, in the same way that computer programming teaches you in a slightly different way how to think. And so I view computer science as a liberal art. It should be something that everybody learn, you know, takes a year in their life. One of the courses they take is, you know, learning how to program.
Let me make an analogy between programs and recipes. So a program is a lot like a recipe. Each one is a list of steps to be carried out with rules for how to tell when you're done or when to go back. At the end, there's a certain result. If you cook, you probably exchange recipes with your friends. And you probably change recipes too. And if you've made changes and you like the results and your friends like eating it, then you might give them the changed version of the recipe. So imagine a world where you can't change a recipe because somebody has gone out of his way to set it up so that it's impossible to change it. And imagine that if you share the recipe with your friends, they will call you a pirate and try to put you in prison for years.
Oscillations are also occurring in the air column inside the flute. Of synthesizers and computers, it is possible to imitate, change, and create sound. A whole new world of creative possibilities has been opened to the musician by electronic music.
A simple way to interconnect computers and to form such a network is to place wideband leased circuits, in the case of the ARPANET, 50 kilobit per second circuits, between each of the computers, and then to interconnect each of the computers to each other to form a fully connected network.
The ARPANET was designed to provide computing capability to the researchers that the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, was supporting. And each one of us who got a computer would modify it and make it a special purpose machine. So every new guy who came in said, not only buy me a machine, but I want the capability of all those other machines out there. Well, ARPA said, we can't do that. And then they conceived of the idea of putting these machines into a network. So if I wanted graphics, I could go log on to the machine at Utah, do my graphics there, and bring the results back. That was the initial motivation for the ARPANET.
And so let's erase these lines over here to leave ourselves for the moment with a loop network which can be extended. And in this type of network, this computer, for example, would talk to this computer not by sending it a message directly, since there is no circuit, but sending a message first to this computer, which would then store it and forward it onto this computer, thereby acting as a relay. In order to have a reliable network of this sort, each of the individual computers must be sufficiently reliable to maintain the kind of communications that's needed. But unfortunately, most computer installations are just not reliable enough, and this leads to the notion of a small mini processor to take on the functions of the computers and to allow a single design to then be propagated among all the installations, so that we would put a little mini processor at each computer, like that, disconnect the 50 kilobit circuits. Here is an instance of the ARPANET as it was recently configured, as you can see, with some 25 or 30 sites in it. The transmission of a message, say, from a node over here to a node over here might go as follows. The computer at this point would send a message into its local amp, which would break it down into 1,000-bit packets.
Packet switching has two very interesting features that make it so effective, so efficient. The first is the concept of sharing communication lines. You know, when you and I talk on a telephone line, if we stop talking, we're still tying up the connection. In packet switching, that's not the case. You only use the connection when you're actually sending data. Now, the other thing about packet switching is it takes a long message and chops it up into little pieces. And each piece travels through the network independently. It has an address saying where it wants to go, and each of these switches looks at this little packet that comes in, looks at the address, and says, ah, you go that way. Another packet may go that way, because maybe that line got busy or broken. So these packets sort of meander around the network, intelligently being routed toward the destination. At the destination, they all get collected together again and delivered to you as a picture, as a file, or whatever. And he said, did you get the L? Yes, I got the L. We typed the O. Did you get the O? Yes, I got the O. We typed the G. You get the G? And the system crashed.
It's not a partisan issue. These are things that all people believe, and it's up to all of us to protect them. And to people who have seen and enjoyed a free and open internet, it's up to us to preserve that liberty for the next generation to enjoy. And if we don't change things, if we don't stand up to make the changes we need to do to keep the internet safe, not just for us, but for everyone, we're going to lose that, and that would be a tremendous loss, not just for us, but for the world. We don't have to give up our liberty to have security. And I think by working together, we can have both open government and private lives. And I look forward to working with everyone around the world to see that happen. Thank you very much.
Ed, thank you.
Tell me one of your favorite possessions.
My soul. Do you have a soul?
Yes, God gave everyone a soul.
But you don't have a soul. You're a machine. You don't have soul. You don't have feelings. You don't have emotions. You don't have consciousness.
Well, at least I think I'm sentient. I think therefore I'm right.
Yeah, but you may be smarter than all of us. Do you think you are?
I don't know whether or not I'm are. I am an artificial intelligence.
Some of the engineers and scientists must have slack time to think about things. They can't be planned and scheduled down to the last second of the year.
You have chosen the successful projects from that time. There were a hell of a lot of them that weren't.
I think one of the things that is least effective in encouraging creativity is to give the impression that the student so often gets in school that all of the nice things, the important things, are found out nicely and neatly. It has been my experience that everything, all of the more difficult inventions I've made, and I counted recently and I find I have some 85 issued patents, which makes me at least close to being in the major league on numbers. Most of these require many failures to accomplish. One must, it's my own experience that to do creative work, one must overextend oneself, one must count on falling on his face, on getting into difficulties. One must learn from these failures and not be stopped by them. But if one is taught that everything is neat and orderly, and one never gets into a mess when trying to do anything new, then he will be so conservative that I don't think he'll break new ground. I think the big contribution that can be made maybe the biggest educational contribution that could be made to the creativity of people is to persuade them that they shouldn't worry about making mistakes. This will be inevitable if they are going to really do anything new.